Good morning and welcome to Crossroads TV. I'm David Fortune, the pastor of Crossroads Basel, and so glad you've joined us this morning and welcome to 2021. Feels good to turn the page on the calendar and have a fresh start and a fresh beginning, and I hope and trust that your holiday season's gone well. I'm sure very different from other years. But in the midst of all that, we continue to trust God and give Him thanks for His goodness and His provision in all things. This morning, this is going to be a little bit scaled down. It's just you and me. I've given Pastor Nico, Pastor Tony the day off. And I just want to take an opportunity to share about a new sermon series and to share some thoughts on Psalm 1. And we're going to take communion in a few minutes. So I'm glad that you are here. And we're looking forward to a new year and a new beginning. It's not unusual to sort of talk about that fresh start and that fresh start at the beginning of a year, that new opportunity that lies before us. And yet, in many ways, we still know that we're in this COVID season, this COVID year. We can kind of see the end, but we're not quite there yet. In fact, we are unable to meet together in person, at least for the remainder of this month, probably into February. I'm not sure when we'll be meeting together in person again. It's going to be Easter before things get a little more normal, maybe the summer before we're really back to normal. And of course, that depends on so many factors that we've learned are beyond our control. But as I've said, we're going to trust God in the midst of that. We're going to believe that God is with us. And we're going to continue to connect and to worship and to encourage one another by whatever means we can in terms of digital and electronic connection in this day and age. We're going to start this year with a look at the book of Psalms. I thought that we're in a season where we're not sure exactly what to be feeling, what to be thinking, how we should be moving forward. We're hopeful, and yet we're cautious. And the one thing about the book of Psalms is that it is so expressive of our many emotions, of our many feelings, of our questions, of our longings and desires. And all of that comes out in this book. All of those things that we're not quite sure what to do with at various times, and we wonder if anybody else has ever felt this way. When we open the book of Psalms and we begin to read some of the prayers that have been poured out before God, we often see our own feelings and emotions, our own longings and desires or questions, our thanksgiving reflected in those prayers. And I want to call this series Borrowed Prayers. I'm not quite sure if that's the right title, but that's the one that kept coming to me, because we know what it is to borrow something from going next door for a cup of sugar or a tool of some kind. We're grateful that we can take something that somebody else has already used or made provision for and make use of it. Sometimes we borrow intangible things as well. We might borrow the strength of family members when we're not feeling so confident or so able, and other people believe in us. And so we say, well, I'm going to draw on your strength. I'm going to borrow your strength and energy for this situation. And that's how I think the book of Psalms has been used down through the centuries, really, as people have wondered, how do I pour my heart out to God? How do I express these things? Is it even right to express these things? And they come to Psalms and they read something that somebody else has already penned and somebody else has already prayed, and that's how I'm feeling. And Lord, can I use that? I'm going to use that to pray to you, to pour my heart out to you, to give my thanks and gratitude, to question where I am at this point in my life, whatever it happens to be. And so there's 150 Psalms. We can't do them all, but we're going to do a selection of Psalms over the next few weeks that give you an idea of some of the things that we find, and talk about how we turn that into prayer to God and how we can use that through this season. We're almost at the end, and yet this last COVID part might be the hardest, might be the most difficult, as we're tired of waiting and wanting change, wanting to get out, wanting to be with friends. And so how can we channel our feelings, our emotions, our thoughts? How can we use the scripture to pray that before God and to make an impact and to grow spiritually? Because I think we all desire to do that, to enrich our faith life at the same time. I've encouraged in an email on Friday, if you want to read through the book of Psalms, we're starting today with Psalm 1 and 2, and by the end of February, we can read through the whole book. And we'll just get a sense then of what God is saying to us and what others have said to God. If you want to join us, there's a reading guide available. If you didn't get it in an email, you can write the office, and we will get that copy to you so you can follow along with us. And I know that not every day sometimes what we read in Scripture resonates with us, but I promise that as you read through the book of Psalms, there will be two or three or four occasions where at the end of a long day or just you find yourself in the midst of something, there's going to be a verse or passage that pops out to you, and you're going to say, that's exactly where I'm at. Lord, hear my heart, hear my cry. Let me borrow these words to pray out to you and to call out to you. So we're going to take the next month, and look at the book of Psalms, read through, talk about our prayer life, talk about strengthening our faith, and trusting God in the midst of wherever we find ourselves. Let's start with a word of prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, as we start this new year, we want to give you thanks for all of your goodness. You've seen us through this past year, and yes, there are disappointments and losses and frustrations, and yet we know that you're still on the throne and that you still rule and reign. And we commit ourselves afresh to just following after you and trusting you in this year ahead, trusting you with our congregation, with our church family, with all of our needs. And Lord, may we not stop to give you thanks and praise for who you are. Just because our circumstances may be good or maybe not so good, we don't want to hesitate to just continue to say that you are good and worthy of all our praise and adoration. You're a great God, and we trust you this morning. We love you this morning. Thank you for your goodness. Be with us in this time, in Jesus' name. Amen.
course, the firm foundation that we have to build upon is Jesus. But what are the things you build upon that foundation so that your life gets stable? That is what the BATA course is all about. Helping you lay a good foundation for your journey through life in connection with Jesus. It is a 7-week course and we're going to cover a lot of things. Like, how did the Bible come together? How should I read it? How should I not read it? How can I be sure of my salvation and that I'm okay with God? And now that I'm following Jesus, how do I go about making decisions in life? And what about faith and science? Do I have to check my brains at the door of the church? Or can I still be a rational being? What about my career and possessions? What about giving of my time and resources? And what is the role of the Holy Spirit in a Christian's life? And how about the church? Is that optional or is it a must? Now, due to COVID, we'll run the course online this time. And we'll use a lot of online clips and illustrations, and you get tips on further resources if you want to dig deeper in some of the subjects. And during the course, you will have a coach that will connect with you regularly so that you can ask your questions, you can share your doubts, your fears, your challenges, and you may get some life-tested input from people that have gone before you in following Jesus. I hope to see many of you online. We'll start at the beginning of January.
So let's begin with Psalm 1. Psalm 1, I think, is a prayer for wisdom, but it also serves as a great introduction to the whole book. The Psalms or the songs were written by many different people. King David, of course, wrote many of them, but there are a number of other authors, and they were a collection of songs that were put together and organized pretty much in the form we have them today, following the return from exile in Babylon. And they were used in Jewish temple worship and Jewish synagogues and in the early church as well as part of their regular worship, sung to God as prayers, as worship, as adoration, because there's a variety found. And it's all about following God in everyday life, just when we're trying to do our best. How do we follow God? How do we live out a godly life? How do we express our worship and appreciation and thanksgiving to Him? Where do we find strength for the day? Where do we go with our questions? How do we grow spiritually? This is what the Psalms are all about. Our everyday life, joys and struggles, desires and disappointments that we all face. And Psalm 1 lays out a theme that's going to be pursued throughout the book, indeed is pursued often in wisdom literature, that there are two pathways. There are two destinations. We're either pursuing a life towards God and His things, or we're pursuing life towards a dead end because we're trusting in ourselves or the things of the world around us. So Psalm 1, beginning at verse 1. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on His law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They're like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. So this basic truth, there are two ways, there are two paths, there are two outcomes, two destinations in life. The way of following God or following our own path, which is anything apart from God and from His wisdom. And each of us chooses a destination and chooses a way to live, a pathway, and decides what we have to follow. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers. Much of the Psalms is poetry, and so you find a lot of imagery and metaphor, also repetition, emphasizing the same thing. And so we see here about walking in step, standing in the way, sitting in the company. It's driving home a certain point here, that the blessed individual, the godly individual, is not the one who is on this particular pathway or is keeping company with the ungodly. The ungodly are simply those that live as if God doesn't matter, as if God doesn't exist. They are unto themselves. And the one who wants to follow God does not keep company or is not like these other people who live as if God isn't there. The wicked, the sinner, the mocker, those are strong words, and we sometimes hesitate to apply that to other people, but it's really just saying those people that are living apart from God. The blessed person is not living apart from God, but rather trying to live towards God. And those that aren't blessed, the sinner, the mocker, they're living unto themselves. And so there are these two different groups. And God says one is blessed and the other is not. It doesn't say that the blessed person is perfect or has it all together. It doesn't say that the blessed one doesn't have bad days, doesn't find themselves in difficult situation, can't have a fight with their spouse or be lazy and doing certain things or miss their Bible reading time. No, it's not about a life of perfection. Because we'll discover as we go through the book, there's a full range of failures and successes that people can have and still be godly people. This is all about the pathway that we're on and whether we are pursuing the wisdom of God and His way or whether we're going our own way. It has nothing to do with how successful we might be in terms of life activities or whether we have good days or bad days, but where the orientation of our heart lies, towards the things of God or not. The blessed one is marked out by following God's word and living around it, as it says in verse 2. The blessed one whose delight is in the law of the Lord and who meditates on his law day and night. Even people who delight in the law of the Lord can make mistakes. The difference is they're working to center their life around God's word, around God's desires, around how they believe God would have them live out life day to day. They meditate on his law day and night. That means they're actively incorporating God's word into their living. This isn't about joining a monastery and becoming a monk and chanting or humming to yourself all day. This is about taking God's word into ourselves and saying, now, how does it make a difference in terms of how I live, how I go to work, how I treat my family, how I pay attention to my neighbors? What is God's word saying to me? I need to wrestle with those things. I need to think about those things. I need to meditate on those things. This is what it means to be on God's pathway, to be taking in his word and to be wrestling with it, meditating, let it shape our lives rather than the culture around us shape our lives. The blessed one thinks about how they can spend their time living a godly life. Jesus said to his followers in John chapter 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus is the way to knowing God, or better yet, is God. He is the way of a godly lifestyle. And we use that word way in a couple different ways. It can have some different meanings. It can refer to something very concrete, very specific, a noun. It can be an actual pathway, a road that we drive on. This is the way. This is the road that we take. It's a definite, concrete thing referring to the what or the who. So Jesus is the way. He is the one to God the Father. He is the one to our relationship with God. But it can also refer to, that word way also refer to how we do things, how we live our life. We were just recently in Rhonda's hometown, small city in northern Ontario where she grew up, and she knows that place very, very well. And I've gotten to know it, but I don't know it as well. And as we went around having to do some errands, there would be a destination we would have to get to, and she would assume that this is the only way to get there, and I would know a different way to get there, and we would have a discussion about the best way or the right way to get to our destination. In fact, there were multiple ways. One might be faster, one might be shorter kilometers, but take longer. There were different hows, even though the destination was the same. And I think when Jesus says, I am the way, he's not only the destination, he is also the how, the way in which we live. It's not just that we're on our way to an eternity with him, but how we live each and every day requires God's wisdom, because we want to live in the way that Jesus would live. How we live our daily lives matters. Do we live like Jesus would? The godly person isn't just the one who's forgiven and on their way to heaven. They're the one that are working out their daily salvation, learning to live the hows of life, learning to live the Christian way. What does it mean to live in a godly way in the world around us now? We need God's wisdom for that. That's why we need to be meditating on his law day and night. The first followers of Jesus were referred to as the followers of the way. It wasn't until later in Antioch that they were referred to as Christians, but first of all, they were followers of the way. There was a different lifestyle. There was a destination, sure, but the lifestyle mattered. How they were going to live, what they were going to do in their relationships, how they approached their work, all of that would change because they were followers of Jesus. And I think the psalmist is saying the same thing here. There are two destinations, but there are two different ways to live. There's a way of living where God is incorporated into each and every day and into all of our decision making. And then there's a way of living which says, I'm not really interested in what God has to say to me. Verse 6 tells us, the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. One way leads to eternal life, and the other way leads to a dead end. And how we live matters. And so the righteous, the blessed person, are those that are attempting to live for God. They're aware of God's presence throughout the day, and they desire to sort of live in a way that matters while they're on the pathway to this destination. Verse 3 says, that person's like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf doesn't wither. Whatever they do prospers. We're not used to metaphors that compare people to trees, but I guess that was popular in the day when this was written. What it means is that person who lives in this godly way is going to be strong, is going to be healthy. They're going to be well nourished by that water. And they're going to be productive. They're going to yield fruit. They're going to be a blessing to other people because of how they live. We can take strength and shelter and shade from a healthy tree. And so it's just saying that those people that are on that way, they're going to be prosperous. Their life is going to be better off. And they're going to be a blessing to God and to others because of how they live. The other path, not so much. Not so the wicked. They're like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. All of their efforts aren't going to matter as much. You can live in a way that has lasting impact, or you can live in a way that's just going to wind up being worthless in the long run. So there are two ways. The way of the righteous is guided by God's word, and the way of the righteous live is guided by God. The how of how we live day to day, searching God's word for daily health and well-being, not always getting it right, failing and having to ask for forgiveness, having bad days, suffering setbacks, having questions and doubts about faith and all of those sorts of things, just the ordinary everyday stuff. But they continue to pursue God. They continue to turn to his word. They continue to ask, how should this make a difference that I'm a follower of Jesus in how I respond to other people? And that's how we know we're on the road to the right destination. And I think that's what the book of Psalms is really going to flesh out. How do we live and how do we pray so that we become the people that God has called us to be? With all of the problems we face in life, with our questions about the nature of God, our failures, our victories, when we sense God may be not there, when we are overwhelmed by the grace and gratitude of God, when we're concerned about other people, all of these things, we wrestle with God's word and we keep on living it out. Rather than turning to the wisdom of the world around us or the wisdom that we think we bring all of that before God and we say, I need your wisdom. I need your help and strength. So how can we take this psalm and make it our prayer? As I think this is a great prayer for the year 2021. And I think we do something like this. As we come to this psalm and we read it, we can just turn it into a prayer to God. Lord, I want to be on the right path. Lord, I want to be the blessed one. I want to be the one that has your wisdom. Help me to be on the right path and to avoid the wrong path. Lord, I want to be like that strong tree. I want to be that strong individual that's a blessing to other people. Lord, I know that I may not always get it right, but help me be on the right path to you. Lord, it says you know the way of the righteous. Help me to be found, Lord, amongst the righteous. Lord, help me to meditate on your law day and night. Help me to figure out how I incorporate your word into my living. As I think about my home life and my work life and how I go about business in the world. Help me know how to live with your wisdom and guidance. See, I think we can take a psalm like that and just personalize it and say, Lord, this coming year, I need your wisdom. I need your strength. I want to be on the right path. I want to know not only that I have a heavenly destination, but I want to know in this life, how do I live? Jesus, how do I follow you? God responds to our simple prayers. God responds to those requests. And I think when we keep that before us each and every day, it keeps us humble as well. We don't know what will happen this year, but we can ask God for wisdom to make it through whatever lies ahead. And the psalm says that's how we can know that we'll be blessed, when we keep God and his word in the center of all that we do.
Gift of love and righteousness. Father, once he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I
Christ alone, that we have hope, that we have confidence, that we can look ahead into this year and be hopeful that God is with us and that God has not forgotten or abandoned us, or that whatever comes our way, we can turn to Him in our moment of need. It's because of His life and His ministry and His sacrifice that we can be saved, and that we have the strength through the Holy Spirit to follow Jesus on the godly pathway, and to determine each day to get up and to follow Him. And as we come to the Lord's table this morning, we want to commit ourselves afresh and anew to following Him in this year, to trusting in Jesus. Not only trusting Him that He takes us to the Father, but living in a way that's pleasing to Him. The how of life, to follow and to behave and to act in a way that Jesus would act and behave. And we need His wisdom and His guidance in each and every day. The Apostle Paul wrote these words in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I received from the Lord what I passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, He also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." Let's pray together this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather together at this table, we know that we are not alone, that we are partaking together in your presence. And all around the world this morning, your church gathers. We are united in our faith, in our trust in you, and united at this common table. And we especially look forward to the day when we can celebrate together with one another in our congregation, but also the day when you come and we celebrate with you. Until then, we want to come and commit ourselves afresh and new to repent of our sins and to ask you to lead and to guide us. Lord, we confess that we have sinned against you in our thoughts and in our words and in our deeds, by the things that we have done and the things that we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We are sorry for these things, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your name. Amen. So if you want to take the bread where you are this morning, this is the body of Jesus Christ that is broken for you. Let's take and eat in remembrance of him this morning. Likewise, he took the cup. This cup represents the blood of Jesus that was shed for the remission of our sins and for our salvation. Let's take with thanksgiving this morning. It's great to have a fresh start and a new year, but remember what God's word says, that his mercies are new every morning. We can get up each and every day grateful for God's forgiveness, for his strength. And as we commit ourselves to follow him and to follow the godly pathway, that'll be our primary goal this year, to follow after Jesus and to understand that better and to grow spiritually. Everything else is going to be secondary to that. But if we commit first our primary desire to follow after him and his way, I think then we'll be successful in all that we do. Thank you for joining us this morning. If you want to join us at 11 a.m. at the Amici Coffee Bar, we'd be happy to chat with you then. The details are on the screen, and we'd love to see you then. We're going to be here next Sunday morning, 10 a.m., as we continue in this new year. God bless you. Have a great week.